Thanks, Mr. Jeevan, and good evening to human rights defenders and human rights activists and friends. It's a very sad moment that so many of us are gathering, but I think Father Stan would have liked it very much that we turn the sadness into a dedication to remove the law that he fought for and that he ultimately paid his price for. I'm reminded of a letter that he wrote from inside the jail, where he called it a cage bird can still sing. He said, first of all, I deeply appreciate the overwhelming solidarity expressed by many during the past 100 days behind the bars. At times, news of such solidarity has given me immense strength and courage, especially when the only thing certain in prison is uncertainty. Life is here on a day-to-day basis. Another strength during these past 100 days has been in observing the plight of the undertrials. Majority of them come from economically and socially weaker communities. Many of such poor undertrials don't know what charges have been put on them. They have not seen their charge sheet. They just remain in prison for years without any legal or other assistance. Overall, almost all undertrials are compelled to live to a bare minimum, whether rich or poor. This brings in a new sense of brotherhood and communitarianism, where reaching out to each other is possible only in this adversity. On the other hand, we 16 co-accused in the Bhima Koregaon case have not been able to meet each other as we are lodged in different jails or different circles within the same jail. But we will still sing in chorus. We will sing, a cage bird can still sing. Friends, I think we should become the birds that will sing the song of freedom, sing the song of liberty, sing the song that we will not allow this extremely brutal regime at the center to be able to crush our voices or to silence our voices. I think that is the best tribute that we can pay for Father Stan, whose death was wholly unnecessary, completely unjust, and whose blood stains are there in the hands of the NIA, it's there in the hands of the central government, it's there in the hands of the prison department, and it's also there on the hands of the judiciary. I think it's now time that we really come together as a nation to raise our voices that we will not allow such injustice to take place. And this manner in which Father Stan so poignantly wrote, the hundreds of prisoners who are in jail who don't know what they were arrested for, who have never seen the charge sheet, who will never know what freedom will be. I think it is we should come together to honor Father Stan by honoring all these people who are there in jail in hundreds and thousands across all over India. And we shouldn't really come together only for a few people who we know, but we should give a call in terms, especially now under the COVID, with the third wave threatening to overtake us, we should give a call to decongest the prisons. We should give a call for the release of all political prisoners. And we should give a call for saying, let action be taken against the guilty police officers who have filed all these false cases, not just against Stan, but against many other people. Friends, many of you are not strangers to the abuse of law. Many of you are not unknown in terms of how the police can file false cases against activists. Some of you have been the targets of the recent UAPA case in Munchingput. You know, and the number of people who have been implicated in that, the houses that were raided, the number of people who were arrested in jail. So I don't need to talk about how brutal the UAPA has been used. And this has been used not just by the central government of BJP. It's been used by various other state governments also. So during this time of a tragedy, let's remind ourselves that it has nothing to do only with one government. It was ultimately the UPA government which brought in the amendment to the UAPA law, which has made it an extremely draconian law, in which bail is an impossibility. In which once you are in, you can hope to come out only at the end of 5, 6, 8, 10 years, whenever the trial ends and 98% of those who are arrested come out because they are acquitted. The question is, should we wait for that many years? Should we wait for the entire system, the criminal justice system, to collapse, or should we do something about it now? It's very interesting. For the last 6 years after this present central government has come to power, especially in the last 2 years, we've been hearing daily about some people being arrested under the UAPA or under the NSA or under some of these draconian laws, including the sedition law, across various parts of the country. Many of us have also been feeling extremely sad and extremely frustrated about the complete non-response of the judiciary, whether the lowest judiciary or the highest judiciary. Many former Supreme Court judges have talked about the abdication by the constitutional courts. And these are strong words. They have abdicated the responsibility of being sentinels of the constitutional scheme in India. Now, why? Why did this happen? Is, I think, something that stands death should give us a chance to ponder over. Now, while the last 3 years in particular, last 7 years in general, have seen a massive assault on academics, on activists, on people from the creative fields, on students, on women, on a wide variety of people in the Dalit movement and the Adivasi movement. In particular, the last 3 years has seen a complete silencing of democratic voices of the human rights movement, civil liberties movement, women's movement, environment movement. Let's not forget the Disha Ravi. Let's not forget also the Greenpeace warriors who the Modi government attacked immediately after coming to power. The reason that we need to talk about this is the very sad reality that the official opposition in India has actually become a non-player. You don't see the opposition parties in India raising issue about, for example, petrol price hike. Where are they in talking about the false arrests across the country? They are not to be seen anywhere. It is in this context that this entire field of critically examining the public policies of the government, of criticizing and opposing the way in which looters and plunderers in the name of corporate bodies are taking over our common property resources, in the way in which much of our resources are being handed over to a variety of foreign interests, that responsibility has fallen onto many of the movements. Some of them are the grassroots movements of a variety of forms. And these movements have been raising these issues over the last few years. Let me just give you a few examples. The Environment Protection Act has been drastically remodeled, enough to now let a polluter pollute and get away with blue murder. Any project required pre-project clearance, environment clearance to start. That law has been changed. They can start it, and after they start, they can now apply for clearance. This law has unfortunately been pushed forward and become law also in the, for example, the coastal road regulation zone legal framework. Likewise, you see changes in land acquisition law. You see changes in the corporate laws. You see changes in many other protective laws, which are meant to help to protect the rights of ordinary citizens, particularly the most vulnerable people. This field has now been, this arena has been filled by the human rights groups, by the various rights groups, environment rights groups, women's rights groups, Dalit rights groups, Adivasi rights groups, and various other rights groups who have actually taken on the role of a democratic opposition to extremely brutal, repressive, and regressive central government, and its cronies in the various other states. And therefore, the attack on many of the rights movements, especially in the last 3 years, particularly after they came back to power in 2019. That's the only way we can make sense of this senseless arrest of the 16 people in the Bhima Koregaon case. Now, behind that is also what we could see the dominant nature of the Indian state and both the central government and the state government. That in the last 2 months, we are suddenly seeing a change in the way some of the courts have responded. Many of the courts have now started giving bail. Many of the courts have actually discharged a good number of people. For example, Akhil Gogoi was discharged in 2 cases. He's a sitting MLA in Assam, from Sibsagar district. He was kept inside for opposing the CAA. For 19 months, he was kept in jail. There was Bashir Ahmed Baba, who is actually a programmer from Srinagar, came to Baroda to learn how to treat post-cancer survivors. He was interested in providing healthcare. In 2010, he came to Baroda. He was picked up in a case, thrown in jail, and 11 years afterwards, recently, about 2 weeks back, he was acquitted, where the court said there was no reason why he had to be arrested at all, because there's absolutely no material against him. In Nanded in Maharashtra, Mohammed Irfan was released after 9 years. 2 months back, 122 Muslim accused were released in a case in Surat after spending 11 years in jail. We can keep on increasing the number of such people. A very important public policy question comes. That they are arrested, that they are acquitted is something we would celebrate and we would be happy about. But these are young people who have paid very, very brutally with the youth, with the time in which they could have built up their own profession and their own occupations, who have lost their, literally their lives. Who is going to pay, and how are we going to make the police officers accountable for misusing and abusing the law? It is here that the Delhi High Court's ruling in the three people where they gave bail, Devangana Kalita, Asif Iqbal, and Natasha Narwal, is very poignant. And I would like to remind us, because what the Delhi High Court said is something that we should now call out loud and clear, irrespective of whether we go to jail or not. The Delhi High Court said, this court cannot countenance the state crying wolf. This court cannot countenance, cannot cope with, cannot allow the state crying wolf. Friends, that's exactly what is happening now. Anybody raising a voice, the state cries wolf. These are anti-nationals, these are traitors, these are foreign agents, these are XYZ. And finally, these are also terrorists and urban naxals. With this fear, they've caught the whole country into that fear. Delhi High Court, just about 2-3 weeks back, called the bluff of the central government saying, we will not allow this to happen. Friends, that is what Stan's death poses before us. We cannot afford to remain quiet. We have to call the bluff of the central government, whatever be the price that we have to pay for it. In Father Stan's case, in the 100th day of his arrest in January, POCL, along with various other groups, came together to talk about the UAP arrest in the country. Before that, when soon after his arrest, we had a national level press conference where on the same platform, 6 to 8 major national level political parties came together to give a very unified call for the repeal of UAPA. The most important part of it was an unambiguous call. There was no if, there was no but. CPIM came, CPI came, various other parties came. The Chief Minister of Jharkhand also talked about and gave a televised address for about 4 to 5 minutes, in which he very clearly called upon all the opposition parties to keep aside their difference and come together on the same platform, because at peril was democracy in the country. That was followed by the 100th day of Father Stan's arrest, which became an occasion for which many groups from throughout the country came. Our friends from Andhra, the CLC friends from Andhra, and the HRF friends from Andhra and Telangana participated in these meetings. And I would like to say it's with great joy that what Jeevan addressed now, saying that the circular of the GO of the government of Telangana banning 16 organizations under the UAP Act has been withdrawn. I think it's a great success. Coming on the day immediately after Stan's death, it gives us a hope that we can actually oppose all that is going on. Now, when one of the things that emerged from the meetings with Stan after working on the issue of Father Stan and the Bhima Koregaon 16 was that we need to have statistics about cases where people have gone in. And we started doing the statistics. It's an ongoing process. I would like to request all friends here who have data about UAPA to please contact us and give it to us. And we came across very interesting findings that of the 386 cases which are now currently under the NIA, 312 cases relate to UAPA cases, which counts about 80% of the cases. Of this 80%, 75% of all the UAPA cases have come after the Modi government has come to power. Friends, I'm repeating, 75% of all the UAPA cases that are now being investigated by the NIA were registered after the present Modi regime came to power in 2014. That is up till today, up till about 10 days back. Now, what does it mean? It means that this government is on a very, very open course of trying to suppress all democratic movements and all democratic voices. That's very, very clear. Now, out of this cases that we studied, the NIA cases, and we still have not been able to gather data of UAPA cases from the rest of the country, which is the state government police investigated cases. We found that 66% of all the cases involved conspiracy charges. Now, when you actually remove the conspiracy charge, many times no anti-terror case stands. I've been handling anti-terror cases from the 90s. I used to work with Kanaviran, and we worked together for 20 years until he passed away. There was a very interesting thing that he taught us. And he said, the law defines the offense. The law defines the offense, but the state defines the offender. Friends, with the wisdom of five decades of practice, Kanaviran beautifully put it in one line. And it took me many, many years as a practicing lawyer to really understand what it means. Law may define anything as an offense. Ultimately, it's the state which actually uses the law to arrest people, which is why in the Delhi violence cases, they let out a Kapil Mishra. They let out Anurag Thakur, who was a minister of the central government, who openly gave a call for attack on the Muslims, who openly gave a call for violence in public forum, televised addresses, no action taken against him. On the contrary, students of Jamia, students of JNU, students of Delhi University, the ones who took a call against the CAA, they were targeted and arrested in the Delhi violence cases. I have a request to all of you. Please don't call the Delhi violence cases as Delhi riots. They were not riots. Riot is where there are two parties which are attacking each other. What happened in Delhi was a pogrom. What happened in Delhi was a very clear one-sided attack by Hindutva groups on Muslims. And all the main perpetrators were let out. All the ones who stood for liberty, who stood for the constitution, many of them have been arrested, including under the UAPA. In a answer to a question in the Lok Sabha in March this year, based on NCRB, National Crime Records Bureau statistics, it was disclosed that the entire conviction ratio in UAPA cases is only 1.8%, which means 98.2% of all cases filed under UAPA have resulted in acquittals. The reports also showed that overall, there were about 7,700 people arrested under UAPA who are in jail. They were arrested in about 5,128 cases. When we started looking at these figures, we realized that the 7,700 odd cases of numbers of people who are arrested is actually not the right number, because the NCRB statistics do not disclose the total number of Adivasis who are arrested in Chhattisgarh, in Karnataka, in Jharkhand, in Orissa and various other places for a wide variety of reasons. Many of these people, many, many hundreds of these people are still in jail for many years. They've not yet been released. So this 7,500, 7,700 that they are talking about is only a tip of the iceberg. And can you imagine where it takes a minimum of 5 to 8 years for somebody to come out? How many thousands are languishing inside? We are only talking about the Bhima Koregaon. We're only talking about the Delhi violence. We're only talking about a few cases. We need to now expand our voices to cover the thousands of people who don't have a voice, who have been incarcerated and kept inside in jail. It is here that it is very interesting to note from Father Stan's backdrop as to why he was targeted. He came out with a very, very interesting study in 2016. He looked at the entire number of under-trial prisoners in Jharkhand over a 10-year period. And he found out that 46% of the people who were arrested were less than 40. Cumulatively, about 68% of people were below 40 of all those who were arrested. 69% of Adivasis, 42% of them were called the Sarnas, or the people, who are not the Hindus. Though the Hindutva Brigade wants to call them all Hindus, they say, no, we don't belong to the Hindu faith. We have our own faith, and we have the right to call ourselves by our own faith. The Jharkhand government has recently given a call in the census to call themselves as the Sarnas, and not as Hindus. He talked about, for example, Father Stan in a 108-page report, did a very, very detailed analysis of the number, about 4,000 odd under-trial prisoners of Adivasi origin who were in Jharkhand jail for anywhere from 2 to 6 years and more. And he talked about, for example, that the gross misuse of the criminal justice system is on account of the politics of grabbing common resources and handing it over to corporates. Adivasis who had opposed it were put inside jail. Land acquisition, forests, land being given to, say, for mining interests or for big industries. Local people protest, oppose it, they were all thrown inside. In the study, he also showed very clearly how systematically the experience of the thousands of prisoners who are in jail is the experience of blatant torture while in custody by the police. That pre-trial and post-trial is prolonged, and it actually amounts to a second level of torture that they have to face. Many of them have to face multiple foisting of cases against them. Bails are denied on a very prejudiced basis. Okay, there are unwarranted conviction. The large number of acquittals, and the acquittals itself amounts to a gross misuse of the criminal justice system. And he finally, in the study, they point out to the fact most of the people are punished for their political campaigns and for politically opposing the brute state. Friends, this is the report that Stan brought, which then became converted into a PIL in the Jharkhand High Court. Luckily, there was a sensitive judge who ordered notice. That angered the BJP government. Then later on, when the government changed and Hemant Soren government came, all the many of the thousands of prisoners were let out, largely because also the effort of Stan. And this is why he is a beacon, not only for standing for the rights of Adivasis, he also shone a light on the systematic abuse of the criminal justice system against anybody who opposes corporate interests in the country today, who opposes brutal rule of the government in wanting to dispossess the poorest and the most marginalized. He talked of dignity of the poorest. That is something that the present BJP ruled government cannot countenance. They do not want anybody to talk about it. And that is what he paid. He paid in terms of what happened to him in his own life. In terms of the Bhima Koregaon case, he is on record to say, I do not even know where the river Bhima is or where Koregaon is. I heard about it mostly after he got implicated in these cases. Such is the nature of investigation and implication in this case. He then talked about, there are several things that stand out. I want to point out on four or five systemic issues that Stan's arrest and his eventual death highlight. One is a complete unjust nature, unaccountable nature of the abuse of law by the police. Why do I say this? The police raided his house way back in 2018. They once again raided his house in 2019 and two times again in 2020. Now, friends, it's very elementary common sense that if the police raids you, they suspect that you're involved. And if the raids do not show that there is anything to be taken, or conversely, if the raids show that there is something which implicates you in the case, they will arrest you. They do not arrest you in 2018. They do not arrest you in 2019. In 2020, until he was finally arrested, they do not arrest you. What would it mean in terms of pure, sheer common sense? You don't need to be a lawyer to know this, that there is nothing implicating him in the case. Finally, suddenly, they decide to arrest him on October 8th, 2020 and bring him to jail and bring him in custody. A very fundamental question is something that we all need to raise. And this is a question I would like to also say, since bulk of the members who are hearing this are also from Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, it's very much there in the Munching Put case, in the other UAPA cases in Andhra and Telangana, which is the case, why should you need to arrest these people at all? These are political cases. If there is no material to implicate him, barring a confession of a person, what is the need to arrest? Look at the Munching Put case. The police say that they were on a check post, two people come, they saw the police, they drop the vehicle and they run away. The police chase them. And after a long chase after them, they arrest him. And this is supposed to be a hardcore Maoist. Once they arrest him, he suddenly has a change of heart. And then he gives a confession. He gives a confession naming some 60 to 70 people over the last 3 years, wherever he took them. And this man has a memory which is only next to Shakuntala Devi, the prodigy of India of the 80s and the 90s. He's such a prodigious memory. He recalls the name of the person, the father's name, the village he comes from, the place where he took them through the jungle, all this within about 1 hour after he has been arrested after a chase. You don't need common sense to know that if somebody is a hardcore guy, he's not going to sing just because suddenly the police have caught him after a chase. The entire thing is so fake. is so fraudulent. Yet our courts don't even open these cases and ask these fundamental questions. How can a man who's arrested by the police after a chase give in 1 hour's time so many details implicating 60 to 70 people, which led to the various house searches in the last couple of months back? Now, this case, which was there in the state police, suddenly was taken over by the NIA. And this is the second part of the whole issue. Why is the NIA wanting to meddle with all these things? They want to take it up only because they do not have confidence that the state police is going to do it. Why don't they have the confidence? Because they want to make a case that all rights activists are necessary people who are anti-national, traitors, who are terrorists. They need this so that they can project their idea of how they want to make India into a police state. Now, an important point here, friends, and this is extremely important for us to understand, is that we are now dealing with an extremely clever and extremely cunning state who use the law to abuse the law. Now, it's extremely important to understand this particular part, because they have come to power using the legal manner, legal process. Having come to power, they are using the law. But they're using the law by way of abusing the law, but using the law by way of using also the courts in such a manner in which there is no relief that's being given to us. So it's very important to understand this, because if we have to break it, we also will have to talk not only to people like us who are listening to here, we have to reach out to the ordinary citizens of the country to say why all such arrests are not only motivated, but also false. And this is here that the first part is, these are not only motivated political arrests. What is the role of the judiciary? When a man is arrested and brought in, placed in custody before him, is the judiciary to play the role of only being a postman, putting a chapa on the police remand report and giving remand? We have, the Supreme Court has said time and again, the remand court has a very, very onerous responsibility. You are the guardian of the Constitution. You have to look into the police case to find out whether a case is to be made out or not. And if it is not made out, you can release that person on own bond, or you can even throw out the case. It's happened, friends, in Sterlite. After the 13 people were killed, about 400 people were arrested. They were thrown in and they were arrested and taken for remand. The Chief Judicial Magistrate of Thoothukudi said, no, your FIR and your remand report do not disclose an arrest. Do not disclose any criminal offense, much less an offense under the sedition law or under the UAPA, and they threw them out. It's happened here and there, but it can happen only when the citizenship is enlightened and we raise our voices, that it is your duty and it's a constitutional duty, and you are abdicating your duty by becoming like a postman and mechanically filling that role. We have to play that role, because if the courts are not playing that role, it is our duty as citizens to keep reminding the constitutional courts that you have to play that role, not only for you, but for the Constitution and democracy, but also for the future generations. I know I might be sounding very idealistic, but it has happened and we need to do this. It happened when the citizens movement and the human rights movement came together with the likes of Kanabiran and Balagopal against the Tada law. When nobody thought Tada could be thrown out, we were able to do it. Nobody thought POTA could be thrown out, we were able to bring about political change to throw out POTA. So friends, we can come together to demand. It may take a long time, doesn't matter. Stan has paid with his life. Let's become the bird that Stan talked about. The second part, the third part of this entire issue about Stan's arrest is, one, why should you arrest him? You have not arrested him for 3 years of search. You suddenly want to put him only because you want to make him the example for the rest of the country. These are important legal questions. These are not simply issues of emotion because he's an 84-year-old man. It does not matter. You can be a 25-year-old person. But if you have, for 3 years, they have come repeatedly 6 times to search your place, they have not found any evidence to arrest you, and suddenly they arrest you, it means that they've cooked up some evidence. Today, there was a very important press meeting in which a third report of the Arsenal group has come out to say that the entire evidence against Stan and against other people have been planted by using a very, very specialized spyware to plant all these false files in the computers of various people. And those files name various people, including Stan. The third part, and I'll finish off very soon, is the fact that not only is the criminal law being abused, not only is the lower judiciary not asking these questions, the third is on the whole issue of bail. When it comes to bail, unfortunately, P. Chidambaram changed the law after the Bombay blast in 2008. They changed the law in such a way that you can never ever come out on bail. They changed the law to say that under the TADA and under the UAPA, under the POTA law, what it said is that any person can apply for bail and the court can grant bail, provided the court does not come to a conclusion about the guilt of the person. But after the 2008 Bombay incidents, they changed the law to say, provided the documents filed by the prosecution support the accusation against a person. I'm putting it in very layman terms. Now, an accusation is much, much lower than guilt. Unfortunately, what has happened in 2019, the Supreme Court gave an extremely retrograde judgment. A judgment which is a slap on all the face of rights activists, is a slap on the freedoms of the country. They said it is enough if the police has filed a charge sheet or a remand report naming the person. The courts below, when looking at bail, need not look into see as to whether there is sufficient evidence, whether the trial will take 5, 6, 8 years to conclude, whether the evidence is hearsay or not hearsay. The courts are barred from looking into it. All that they have to look at is there an accusation against a person? Is the accusation supported by a document? If these two conditions are met, you can't give bail. The question we need to ask as citizens is, why do you need to have this law at all? You might as well say no bail for anybody accused under UAPA. This was not used very much under the Congress regime. Once the BJP came to power in 2014, they have used this to absolutely ruthless measures. So much so today, you're not able to get bail. Here in the Munshiput case, two people have been granted bail because the judge said there's nothing, no evidence at all. There is one mention in the confession. Beyond that, there is no evidence. I see no reason why they need to be kept inside. And the Vijayawada judge who released them about a month back was extremely courageous in a constitutional sense and released them on bail. Immediately, the NIA has filed an appeal against that in the Andhra Pradesh High Court. The Delhi High Court had the courage to stand up and say, this case need not have been filed under UAPA. UAPA is not made out. They distinguished the earlier Supreme Court 2019 ruling saying the issue of the condition that there should be an accusation and documents will be required only if the UAPA is necessary at all. We don't find UAPA necessary in this case, and they threw out the case. Immediately, Supreme Court has not given a stay, but in effect given a stay. Okay. Now, it is in this condition that you now see that many courts have started giving bail. The Madras High Court has granted bail in another NIA case yesterday. In several other cases across the country, in Assam, Manipur, etc., they have started giving bail. Because even courts, even the most mechanically thinking courts, are now suddenly coming face to face with the fact of the absolute abuse of the UAPA. Friends, this is highlighting to us, we have to start singing as to how terrible this song is. We have to sing the songs of freedom so that the words of our freedom will knock at not just at the gates and the doors of the legislature, but also knock on the doors of the judiciary to say, we as citizens are going to be watching and we are going to be vigilant, and we will raise the voices of democracy as enshrined in the preamble and which are given to us as fundamental rights. The fourth and the last part of the entire stand saga is the issue of the broken prison system. The prison system is stinking. Thousands of people are in jail. Supreme Court said you form a committee and a high-powered committee to let people out. They're not doing it. High-powered committee, unfortunately, in Maharashtra started out the case and they came out with a three-stage classification. Those up to 7 years of jail, those beyond 7 years, and those in special laws. And they said only prisoners who are arrested or convicted for up to 7 years can be let out on bail. Because of COVID, others don't need to be given. Now, that is as much as saying that anybody who goes into jail will not come out. Lots of prisoners, thousands are there. In fact, the numbers have only increased now. And conditions in jails are appalling. Even people who are outside are going through psychological and emotional trauma because of the lockdown. Because we don't have access to livelihoods, we don't have access to food, to water, to medicines. can imagine the plight in the jails. And that's where Father Stan ultimately paid his price. It is very interesting to see the type of counter filed by the government, by the NIA. And friends, this is something we'll shortly come out in the POCL. We'll put together the stand taken by the NIA in opposing bail for Father Stan on medical grounds. He filed 4 petitions on bail. Okay, in all 4 of them, the NIA fought it tooth and nail. And what did they say? The ultimate motive is to overthrow democracy. Now, is Stan going to be, and this is in Stan's petition, by the way. The NIA has filed a counter to talk about the fact that Stan was a person who was, along with others, trying to overthrow democracy. The names they call Stan, they call him suspect. They say the conspiracy is enough because there is enough evidence to talk about it. Okay. They talk about in such ways where they say Lal Johar is a word that is used so commonly in Jharkhand. Our friend John is here. He will know. Lal Johar is used in very many places. In the counter, they say Lal Johar is equal to Lal Salam or to Red Salute. And it means it's an anti-national thing to bring about political secession in India. Now, this is hardly this is hardly the reality. But yet it's put into the thing. Now, who is going to call a bluff? That these are not something on which you put a person in jail and ill-treat him, ending up in his dying. Okay. Then he said, they have given in the report, in the counter, saying, this uncertainty, not age, about the accused has to be taken into account. And Father Stan should not be allowed to use the fact of his age as an excuse to get bail, because he is not entitled to bail. I'm pointing out all this to say, friends, we are living in a regime which is vindictive, which is very vengeful, which is seeking to crush. They have absolutely nothing called mercy. They will throw even an 84-year-old man with Parkinson's and have no compunctions about it. This is the type of a state we are fighting. And despite that, Stan did not allow himself to be cowed down. The BK, Bhima Koregaon, other 15 did not allow their spirits to be cowed down. It is now our duty that we will not allow ourselves to be cowed on, and we will sing the song, and we will sing the song of freedom. That's the only tribute we can pay to Stan. And by doing so, Stan will be proud that his legacy of standing up for the rights of the most marginalized, the voiceless, is being carried out. And he's being carried out not just to talk about political freedoms, but to talk about democratizing the system of criminal justice system in the country, by democratizing the very form of governance in India. Because throughout his reports, you will find his reference to the fact the system is changing, system has to change. And system can change only with enough number of us who are willing to take the risk to stand up and be counted. This is the danger before all of us. This is the challenge. And this is also what Stan represents, the bird who sings. Thank you very much.